In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you suffered for our sin and opened the way to eternal life. Lord, help us.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you were birthed, put to death, and released us from the power of sin and death. Christ, help us.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you sent the Holy Spirit to be our advocate and God. Lord, help us.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit, for it had not fallen upon him
reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts. Always be ready to give an explanation to anyone who asks for you a reason for your hope. But do it with gentleness and reverence, keeping your conscience clear, so that when you are maligned, those who defame your good conduct in Christ may they themselves be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that be the will of God, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered for sins once, the righteous for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put together in the flesh, he was brought to life in the Spirit. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Later, he returned with a big smile.
This story is a good example of the image of our relationship with the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God is always with us. And yet we have to listen to appreciate the presence. We know that and believe that the Spirit is always with us because Christ has promised that. And he said in the gospel today, I will ask the Father, and he will send another advocate to be with you forever. The Spirit of truth. We know that we have the Spirit because Christ has promised the Spirit to us, and Christ's promises are trustworthy. To truly appreciate the Spirit, it is perhaps useful for us to remember what Christ did not promise. Christ did not promise that life would be easy. He did not promise that we would never have to face rejection and pain. He never promised that we would always have a job and always have our health. He has not promised that we would always be successful or we would never make a mistake. All these promises are that which we would probably wish for. But they're not found in Scripture, nor did Jesus say it. What is found in Scripture, however, is the greater promise. Time and time again, Jesus promised us the gift of his own Spirit, so that he would be in our lives forever. He in us, and we in him. Obviously, we believe in that promise, and yet we are told time and also, that we have to listen if we are to benefit from the gift of the Spirit. Truth is, you can't know Jesus apart from the Spirit. Yes, they are two distinct divine persons, but with the Father, they form one God. They never separate from each other. It is always the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, people may know Jesus in some limited historical, academic way. Or in a dry biblical account that they may have heard many years before in Sunday school or catechism. But Jesus wants to share in our lives now. As he said, I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you always. The Spirit of truth. But who is the Spirit? If you rely solely on television and movies or social media, the Holy Spirit is some strange force that makes people jump up and down and clap their hands at revival meetings. Now, the Bible does occasionally associate the gift of the Spirit with fervor or piety in worship, but that's not the best way to describe the action. Consider instead Jesus' words about the Spirit. Today Jesus called him the Advocate. Today's passage is Jesus referring to the Holy Spirit as a defense attorney. Some have defendants in some court of law where we are the defendant. Perhaps Jesus is anticipating judgment day, or Satan or some other evil spirit will accuse us before the throne of God, and the Holy Spirit will be our defense attorney, claiming the mercy of Jesus in our defense. But imagine if not be someone who makes appeals for you, like a Social Security or a Medicare advocate, who works the system to make sure you get maximum benefits, or a healthcare advocate. Talks with doctors and hospitals and insurance companies to make sure one gets the medical care they need. Perhaps the Holy Spirit is a divine spokesman for us before God the Father, or the Holy Spirit prays for us constantly. Even when we pray badly, the Holy Spirit speaks unfailingly to the Father on our behalf. Still, other matter may be found someone who can encourage us, like people on the sidelines cheering us on, or a physical trainer in the gym. Now, I suspect the role of the Holy Spirit is all of the above and so much more. The Holy Spirit is our help, our defense, as our ancestors praying to the Father that we receive from Him the graces that we need, encouraging us, strengthening us to go the distance, to persevere in obedience and love. In our life in Christ, the Holy Spirit gives us special strength to spread and defend the faith by word and action as true witnesses, disciples of Christ, to confess Christ boldly and never to be ashamed of the cross. We must be ready to defend the church. We must show the world the joy, peace, happiness of living in the Spirit of Christ. We must be ready to encourage others who enter the union with Christ. So as Peter exhorts in his epistle, do not fear anyone who might remain and malign you. Do not fear a failure. Do not fear that you will be abandoned or by God. Jesus promises life in the Holy Spirit. And with the life, he shared life with him. And with His Heavenly Father. This union began at our baptism, where the Holy Spirit placed an indelible seal upon our heart, making us a child of God. Then in the sacrament of confirmation, the gifts of the Holy Spirit granted at our baptism are increased and deepened. In confirmation, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit, for the vision that lights our faith with sacred chrism. Today's message perhaps can be best summarized in the words of Jesus. In a little while, the world will no longer see me. But you will see me, because I live, and you will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and my Father is in me, and that you and I are in the Father and in the Son by the power.
Let us stand now together and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God of God, light of light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. Christ came for our salvation. He came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. And rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand. Jesus told His disciples that He is in them and in His Father as well. Therefore, we can be assured that we have a direct way to bring our prayers before God.
For the church, that like the earliest disciples boldly proclaimed Christ to others, revealing them who by
ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Bless our new Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this bread of life, which earth has given and human hands have made, it will become for us the bread of life. Bless our new Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual bread. a similar way, on that same evening, he took the chalice of blessing in his hands, confessing the mercy, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory."
remember, you need song number 612, Come Holy Ghost.
Still continue to basket on the table in the back there. If you wouldn't mind, there's some sanitary wipes back there. You take out the canister thing. It would really help us if you're comfortable to just wipe down with that where you are sitting. And then reservations, I'm not so sure we're going to need reservations for this parish anymore. Not that many people call, and a lot of folks are afraid to come to Mass. Now, maybe in August, the tourists will start flocking here, and we'll have a full church here, I don't know. But by that time, maybe we're on full lockup instead of lockdown. I don't know. So there's all kinds of things that we're just playing by ear. But I would say for the time being, if you want to come to Mass on Sunday and Friday, you can see there's plenty of room between all of us. So I don't think we need to make reservations at this point. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who restores to eternal life with the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace. Lord, by the Lord, by your
love. Thanks be to God.
And please join us in closing.